So today we have pleasure to host Rosario González Ferez from the University of Granada in beautiful town of Granada. So I think Rosario is professor there. She studied there and then she had experience, for example, I think postdoc in Heidelberg and then lots of collaboration and some distinguished visiting positions in Hamburg. And recently she also collaborated very actively with ITAMP at Harvard. And I think part of this work, part of the presentation will be with collaborators from Harvard. So please, the screen is yours.
Okay, thank you very much for this kind invitation, Micha. It's a pleasure to talk to you. Actually, I was there. I was in the chemistry department like 6 years ago, and I really enjoy your city. So I would love to be there and not sit in my room talking to you, but that's how life is right now, and we have to accept it. So for those that, let me see, for those that they have never been in Granada, let me show you some a little bit of where we are. That's Spain, that's Africa, and that's where Granada is located. These are the high mountains we have close here. And I always like to joke to say that we are closest to Africa than anywhere else in Europe if we don't take into account Gibraltar, which is it's not the European Union any longer, but it's still Europe, which is here facing Africa. And that's the mountains we were talking at the beginning of the cities. That's the Veleta, it's not the Mulhacen, it's the second highest peak in Spain, if we don't take into account Canary Island. And this is the beautiful Alhambra constructed by the Moors in the 13th century, even before. And that's the Albaicin. We are not there. I mean, I am not that close to this beautiful part, but I can enjoy the city very much. And the University of Granada was founded in 1531. It's not one of the oldest in Spain. It's like the 10th of the 11th oldest in Spain. And it was founded by Charles V, the Emperor Charles V for Germany. We call him Charles I. And he was the grandson of Isabel and Ferdinand, the Catholic queen and queen and king of Spain. And somehow we had a university before that one, which was the Arabic University, the Madrasa, but it's not the same university any longer. When we talk about our history, we talk about the Madrasa also, but then it was interrupted and a few years later it founded again. So that's where I work, and that's where I am, very south of Spain, of Europe, and very south of Spain also. And today I'm going to talk to you about these Rydberg polyatomic molecules, and the talk is going to be divided in mainly three parts. I will talk with a short introduction with some basic idea that probably most of you know about Rydberg atoms and Rydberg molecules, and then I will talk to two different kinds of Rydberg polyatomic molecules. Let's start with the Rydberg atoms, and I always like to say that somehow Rydberg atoms, they have been always there. We have the first, it was the end of the 19th century when there was the first spectroscopical observation by Armstrong of the atoms, and then we have here the first article by Balmer, and then the following up of Rydberg, where he was able to interpret and to make a generalization of the formula proposed by Balmer, and where the force, how this series was appear and how they depend on n square. And afterwards, this all the highly excited atoms are called Rydberg after him. So somehow I like to say that the Rydberg atoms were there even before we knew what really an atom was, that at that time we were not clear what the idea of an atom or the physical quantum physics explanation of an atom. So Rydberg atoms are given by this kind of system where we have here a core, and then we have a highly excited, one of the electrons in a highly excited orbital, and we can distinguish mainly two different kinds of atoms, of Rydberg atoms. Those that they have a high angular moment, orbital angular momentum, larger normally than 4, more or less, they are called hydrogen-like states, because the electron, the only thing it sees, I mean, what mainly sees is an ionic core, which it can be considered as a point-like charge, and it's orbiting, and it doesn't interact that much with this ionic core. So in a way, it's really like it's like a hydrogenic atom for this large angular momentum state. However, there are this low angular momentum state from 0 to 3, which are called quantum defect state, and the point is that now, the charge distribution is important because the orbit of the electron, it really come close somehow to the, and feel the ionic core, and we cannot describe it any longer as a point particle, the ionic core. So for that state, the energy is given by this expression, which the only difference between the hydrogen-like state and the, and this quantum defect state is the quantum defect state, which can be computed, and it's also measured by, I mean, fitted by a spectroscopy. Here we have this, how this energy states compare for rubidium atom with the hydrogen atom, and we have here the SPDKs, which compare, we see that they are very much shifted compared to the in rubidium compared to the hydrogen atom. And then when we go already to the F state, which they have a very small quantum defect, and they are considered almost the degenerate manifold, they could be considered almost as the degenerate manifold, then we see that they are very much hydrogen-like. So we see with comparison that they are very much like hydrogen system. And Ritmer atoms are very important mainly because of the exotic properties. The binding energy scales at n to the power of minus 2. So that means here we have a comparison of the ground state of rubidium with this 42D state and the 100S state of all of them for rubidium. So the binding energy decreases significantly as the electron is going to this highly excited orbital and they become weakly bound. But at the same time, the radius increase as n square, which means they become very large. In if you compare, they become like 400 times larger or even 1,000 times larger, depending on which orbital will go. So it's really like comparing like one centimeter to 4 meters or 1 centimeter to 4 to 10 meters. So it's really a large difference. And the polarizability scale like n to the power of 10 is similar. There's another scaling for the van der Waals constant and for the dipole moment. And this n very high powers means that they are very sensible to any external field. So that means that they are very, they can be used as proof of the environment of to the interaction with other atom or with external field. So these are very important, the interaction among them. And at the same time, the radiative lifetime increases with n to the power of 3. So that means that they live long enough in order to be able to make experiment with them. This is the transition from the P3 5P 3 half to the 5S 1 half. And then you see that they are really significantly order of magnitude larger. It's like I made, to explain to the student, I made the, it's like comparing 1 second to that one, I think, or to that one, were like 3 hours. So there's really a large difference between both of them. So Ritmer atoms have been important. I think, in my opinion, they have been important in all the development of quantum mechanics and in atomic physics. They have played an important role in quantum spectroscopy, in developing the highly precise in spectroscopy. But during the last maybe 30 years, they have become very important due to the all this cooling technique of laser cooling, evaporative cooling, all this being able to control and manipulate and guide the atoms in an easy way and going to the ultracold regime, they have been very important for Ritmer system, where they play a very important role in developing they are considered to be important for developing quantum computing. They have been, the quantum gates have been, several quantum gates have been developed, have been implemented experimentally with Ritmer atoms. Due to this strong interaction, they are important for quantum sensing, and they could be implemented to test and to measure and to sense very weak electromagnetic field. And they have been also, there are a lot of studies about quantum optics. But what I'm going to talk to you here today is about Ritmer molecules. In a way, we could consider there are a different kind of Ritmer molecules. The first one is where we take a normal molecule, for example, this is a diatomic molecule, and one of the electrons is taken to a highly excited orbital. It's the same idea like the Ritmer atom. We have here a Ritmer core, and then we have a Ritmer electron orbiting around this Ritmer core. That will be one of the kind of Ritmer molecules. Then we have microdimers, which are created when two Ritmer atoms interact between each other, and they could form a molecule. When we excite a normal molecule to a highly excited vibrational state, what we get is that this vibrational structure approach a Ritmer series. And that's another kind of Ritmer molecules, that is heavy Ritmer state of molecules. And like already 20 years ago, it was predicted to have an other kind of RIPB molecule, which are called ultra long range RIPB molecules, where we have a RIPB atom here interacting with a ground state atom. And I will start talking about this molecule. They were what happened is like what we have here is we have the RIPB atom and then we have this ground state atom. And what is happening is like if there is an interaction and a scattering between this, essentially it could be considered only between the electron and the atom. We could neglect the interaction between the RIPB core, the core of the RIPB atom and the atom. And then the ground state atom is proving locally this RIPB electronic wave function and they become bound state. These molecules were predicted by Chris Green and Hussein Saktepu more than 20 years ago, already 21 years ago. And we have here, this is one of the examples of this molecule that will be a S state, that will be the square of the RIPB function of one of these RIPB atom. And then what's happened is we have in the center, we have the RIPB core, we have the electron orbiting around. And in one of these minima, due to the oscillation of the wave function, we have the atom, the ground state atom, the perturber, which is trapped and formed a molecule because there's possibility to accommodate vibrational bound state. So they were predicted and theoretically initially and 9 years later were observed experimentally in the group of Tillmann-Pfau. In a theoretical point of view, the way it's describing is a kind of electron atom scattering with slowly moving electron scattered the ground state atom. And this scattering, this collision is described with the Fermi pseudo potential, which here is given by the S wave interaction of, with S wave being the relative angular momentum between the electron and the atom, and here the P wave interaction. And here we have the S wave scattering length, and here we have the P wave scattering volume. And this is one of the examples from this paper from the experimental observation, where we see that the states oscillate as a function of the internuclear distance. And in this potential wealth, we have several bound states. Compared to a normal molecules, what we see is that the bound state appear very far away due to this huge and enormous, like the wave function of the RIPB electron is very large. And normally the minima of the molecular potential take place in the outer worlds. And that's where we see the bound state. And they are really large molecules. They normally have large dipole moment and they could be easily manipulated. And they have been observed, they have been observed at the beginning only for S wave, they have been observed for D wave, and they have been observed for rubidium and several atoms, now experimentally. So now the molecules I am going to address here, they are a little bit different. Because what we do now is to say, okay, what's happening if we change this ground state atom by a ground state molecule? That will be the molecule I'm going to talk about here. And now what's happening is this diatomic ground state molecule will have the RIPB electron wave function, and there is an interaction between both of them, between the RIPB atom and the ground state molecule. We want to have a polar diatomic molecule in the ground state in order to have a dipole moment. In this case, the binding mechanism is that it's an isotropic anisotropic scattering of this RIPB electron with the dipole moment of this diatomic molecule. And there was a theoretical proposal by Seth Ritterhaus and Hussein Saktepur in 2010. And what they assumed was that the diatomic molecule, it could be described as a two-state model, which is true or might be a good approximation for a large amount of molecules, diatomic molecules, but it's not the case for many of them. And what you have here is this electronic structure of this rubidium with a lambda doublet dimer. And you see that there's a lot of these have the several maximum and minima. This is the potential as a function of the internuclear distance. And we see again, as in the previous case, there are oscillation as a function of the internuclear distance. That will be the separation between the RIPB, like the core of the RIPB atom and the diatomic molecule. And these minima are deep enough in order to accommodate bound state. And here in that case of the diatomic, the lambda doublet dimer, we have the red and the black curve, which essentially indicate in which direction is the dipole moment of the molecule pointing. If it's pointed towards the core, or that will be the L case, or away from the core, that will be the R minimum. So when I started to collaborate with Hussein Saktepur about that, was because we decided that most of the diatomic molecule cannot be considered as a two-state model, and indeed the rotational structure of the molecule have to be taken into account. So if we consider a heteronuclear molecule, and then we consider the Ritter atom, the interaction in that case, what we have is the diatomic molecule, what it sees essentially, and that's where the interaction comes from, it sees an electric field due to the core of the atom and due to the Rydberg electron of the atom. And we know that when we have a field-free molecule, diatomic molecule, most of the case for the diatomic molecule, we could consider the Rydberg-rotor approximation to describe the interaction with electric field. In the field-free case, there will be the field-free Hamiltonian. We have just rotational kinetic energy, and the molecules, the dipole moment is pointed in any direction. It's only defined, actually, the dipole moment when we include an electric field. And then if we include this DC electric field, what it happened, we have the interaction of the molecule with the electric field through the dipole moment. And then the effect is to orient the molecule in the laboratory fixed frame along the direction of the electric field. So if the DC field is pointed upwards, this is a little bit exaggerated, of course, most of the dipole moment will be pointed in the same direction. If I point it downwards, it will be pointed to that last direction. And orientation means the confinement of the molecular fixed axis in the laboratory fixed frame of the, but adding a well-defined direction of the moth, of the dipole moment. So that's what we have to take into account, the rotation and with this interaction. So this work was done in collaboration with Seth Rittenhouse, Hussein Saktepur, and Peter Smelke. So let me explain you how we describe. This will be the molecule we are considering. The Rydberg molecule is potassium in a Rydberg excited state, in a Rydberg state, the potassium atom interacting with KRB. So our system will be like that when it's plotted here in this scheme here. I consider the it will be potassium. Sorry, I didn't realize about that one. That will be the core of the atom. We have somewhere here the Rydberg electron, and we have here the diatomic molecule. And then we describe this system within the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation. And then what we have is we have the Rydberg electron Hamiltonian, which is given here, is the interaction between the electron and the core, which is just the rotation, the kinetic energy, plus the pseudo potential describing this Rydberg electron. And then we have the Hamiltonian of the molecule, which is given by the interaction of the kinetic energy plus the interaction of the dipole moment of the molecule with this electric field produced by the core and by the Rydberg electron. What I am fixing here is that R will be the coordinate of my new molecule, the internuclear coordinate of my new molecule. Then I'm going to solve the Hamiltonian for different values of R. That will be the R that it was before in all my figures, was the separation between the diatomic molecule and the core of the Rydberg atom. So we solve this the Schrödinger equation of this Hamiltonian for different values of R. And for the sake of simplicity, we assume that the diatomic molecule is located along the set axis. If there's no external field in my system, is there not any other electromagnetic field, I have the freedom to decide where the quantization axis is. And that's why for simplicity, I just consider this the diatomic molecule located in this set axis. We solve this Schrödinger equation, making a basis set expansion in terms of a couple bases. So we have here the Rydberg electron wave function, which are obtained by solving this the Schrödinger equation associated to the Rydberg electron Hamiltonian. That will be the Rydberg electron wave function. And then we have here the field-free rotational wave function of the diatomic molecule, which are just the spherical harmonics. We go from L, N, to a total angular momentum, J, and then here is just the Clebsch-Cordan coefficient to go from the uncoupled basis to the coupled basis where we work. So we wanted to work with potassium. So this is the potassium Rydberg state that will be how the electronic structure for this atom look like. We have here the degenerate manifold, and then we have here with N is fixed, that will be general for any N value. And then we have below, the closest state will be the NF state. And then we have here the N plus 2S state, then ND, and then N plus 1P. The different N just depend due to this interaction with the Rydberg core, as I told you before. Here I have an example of for N equal 41, how they are shifted this level from the degenerate manifold. I put the zero in energy to the degenerate manifold. And they show here in gigahertz how much are shifted from the degenerate manifold for this example. Of course, this scale in energy, which is gigahertz, will change depending on the N of the Rydberg electron principal quantum number. For KRB, the rotational constant is of the order of 1 gigahertz, and they have a small, it has a small dipole moment. It's 0.57, 0.6 debye. And in our calculation, what we do is we include rotational excitation up to 6, and we have checked that that's enough to get converged. And for let me go back to the Rydberg electron. For the Rydberg electron, we assume that one of these manifold is enough to get converged results. We not only assume, we have checked that the neighboring manifold, they are far enough in energy and they will not contribute to this electronic structure. So with all of that, we solve the Schrödinger equation for several values of R, and we get in a very simple ab initio way, the electronic structure of this ultra long range molecule. And that's what we get for this electronic structure of potassium Rydberg atom with KRB. So now, when the molecule is far away from the Rydberg atom, what we just have is the two independent system. And then in the limit of very large R value, R much larger than one, the separation is very large. What we see is that the energy, they should go to a constant value, which is given by the Rydberg electron energy plus the rotational structure of KRB. So in this figure, I saw the energy as a function of this internuclear distance, the potential energy curve as a function of this internuclear distance. And I have put the dissociation limit at that energy, which is the degenerate manifold interacting with KRB not excited, not rotational excited. And then we have in different color, I hope they are all very dark, very, very dark, but I think you can see them. Here in black, started in black, the lowest level will be potassium 42P with KRB in the ground state. And then I have potassium 42P, first excited KRB, KRB excited N equal 2, N equal 3, N equal 4, N equal 5, until I find potassium in the Rydberg state 41 with the rotational now levels of KRB. That will be 0, 1, and then the blue will be 2, and so on, until I reach the green, which is for potassium 43S with KRB ground state here, first excited state, N equal to 2, and so on. So that will be that, like that. And all these red states here are shifted from the degenerate manifold. All of them are shifted down from the degenerate manifold. If we make a sum of this figure, what we see, for example, for this 41D with KRB in equal N equal to 2, that indeed is not completely flat. I have some oscillation, there are some well. These lines indicate where the vibrational bound state of this potential will be. And the point is that there's a narrow vibrational spacing. And it's so narrow that it might not be observed experimentally because they are very, it's below the heat, it's in the limit of a few megahertz, very low megahertz. So now if I go to the red parts, which are the red levels, which are the ones sifted from this degenerate manifold, what I see is they have a rich electronic structure. There are many potential wells, and actually the depth of this potential well is much larger, is larger. And if I look to one of these minima, I have many bound state, and then the separation between these states is larger. So this state could be observed or resolved, let's say better resolved experimentally, which while this one, they might have a lot of more complicated issue. They will be a little bit more complicated to be resolved experimentally. So our questions was, well, let me tell you what's the problem. Experimentally, normally, these Rydberg atoms are produced in a two-photon process. So they go from the S state to a P state, and then from the P, they go then to the S or D state in the Rydberg case. So they are two-photon process. That means that they easily access experimentally any of the quantum defect state L equals zero or L equal two. But all these degenerate states, which are coming from the Rydberg manifold, the Rydberg degenerate manifold, are not so easy to access experimentally. So the states that we know they can be resolved properly, they cannot be obtained so easy experimentally. So we ask ourselves if we could engineer some kind of large coupling to increase the vibrational spacing in those states evolving from a quantum defect state, in those states evolving from L equal to zero for the Rydberg electron or L equal to two. So to engineer some coupling, what I am plotting here to see how we can shift it, what I'm plotting here is energy shift as a function of the principal quantum number of the Rydberg electron. That will be the tilted lines here. And that for potassium, the green line is the shift, this the energy shift. That's actually correct, that the energy shift from the S state to the neighboring, the generate manifold, and the blue one will be from the D state. So that's the only valid for S. It will be S and D from the blue state. So that's how depend on the principal quantum number. And this kind of pink horizontal line indicates the energy of the KRB, of the rotational states of KRB. So we have here N equal one, N equal two, N equal three, and N equal four. And that means that if I look here in that region where they cross the lines over here, I know that I'm going to shift one of the KRB states plus the rotational, the electronic atom in a n close to the degenerate manifold. So in that region over here, for example, I will manage to find KRB excited in n equal to two, plus potassium in, for example, in that case will be S state, very close to the degenerate manifold when I combine both of them. And that means I could find a state sifted down and mixing with this state which I sift upwards. So let me show you again with some numbers. So I have here again the electronic extractor of the Rydberg state of potassium. And I have the example here for 46. And what we see here is that the 58S is around minus 6.8 gigahertz. Now, KRB, as I said to you, is around 1 gigahertz, a little bit more than 1 gigahertz. That means that 6B, which is the energy of this state, is 6.66 gigahertz, which means that this state with this state, if I add both together, they will be close to the degenerate manifold with potassium rubidium close to In the ground state, sorry, with the diatomic molecule in the down ground state. So we did the calculation for this example here. That's again the same figure, electronic structure, potential energy curve in gigahertz as a function of the internuclear distance between the core and the diatomic molecule. And I see a similar structure before. I'm only taking into account the state that they are shifted to under the Rydberg degenerate manifold. And then what I see here is this horizontal line, which is the different compared to before, with coming from this 58S with KRB in n equal to 2. And if I make a zoom, what I see is that there are many avoided crossings between one state shifted from the degenerate manifold and the state shifted upwards from this 50S2. And in this, due to the avoided crossing, there are a lot of mixture. And even more important, this bound state, this potential well accommodate bound state, and this vibrational bound state, they have a larger vibrational spacing. And if I look into the wave function of this vibrational bound state, I need to know if I have added some S character in order to tell to the experimentalist, yes, you can photo associate there because you have enough population from the S Rydberg state. And this is what I am plotting here. I'm plotting the weight of the total wave function, the weight of this of the Rydberg electron orbital as a function of the orbital angular momentum of the Rydberg electron. So since this is coming, part of the state is coming from the degenerate manifold, what I see here is that they have a large, in both states, I have a large contribution of this degenerate manifold state. They are significant and many states are populated, but due to the avoided crossing, I have engineered, I have a significant population on the Rydberg S state, this 58 S state. And it's larger than 5%. I was told by my experimental colleague that if they have larger than 5%, they manage to a photo associate there. So somehow we have managed to engineer this coupling and to acquire the state that acquire enough population from the S state to have it to be able to photo associate. So now, once we have done all this calculation and we have talked to experimental colleagues, they told us we don't want to work with potassium, we want to work with rubidium, and we have to check that they was happening again for rubidium. As one should expect, that is a general, it should be a general effect. And that's what we see here now is the same figure as before, but now the lines correspond, the tilted lines correspond to rubidium. And then we see that there are many states that they could where we could find this coupling. And then we have here some example, if we go to excite to KRB n equal to 2. The experimentalists always wanted to excite to due to the way they form ultra cold KRB. They wanted to have also always KRB in n equal to 2. And then we see here that we have many bound states. So we did the calculation for this 46 rubidium now, n equal 46 and for L larger than 3. And we have a similar picture here, electronic structure, potential energy curve as a function of the internuclear separation between the core and the diatomic molecule and KRB. And then we have here two examples. The first one is an avoided crossing between this green state and the this lila state with this 49S. And then we have here another one with 47D with KRB now in n equal to 4. And if I make a zoom, this 40 with the upper one, with KRB now n equal 4, again, we see the avoided crossings here, we have here, I am plotting here the square of the vibrational wave function, and there are many bound states located at very large, all of them at very large internucleus distance, and then, internuclear separate, like the vibrational spacing, sorry, between this state is around 60 megahertz, which is large enough to be resolved experimentally. And if we go to this state here, which has, it's also very nice, we have KRB in n equal to 2. We have here a bound state, which will be stable. The other one will not be stable. But then we have vibrational spacing with this 42, which is not too bad. And even more important, if we look to the contribution of the S stake, we see here that there are many partial waves that populated. There are many partial waves that they are populated, but they have a significant population of this N state. So being a theoretical physicist, I decided to make an experimental proposal for my experimental colleagues, So I tell them how to create this molecule. So they should create ultra cold samples of KR, potassium and rubidium. They should be able to form KRB, which is, they have been done in several groups, especially in Kanquen in Harvard, in Kwanken Ni in Harvard, and in either in the N equal to two or N equal to zero or two. Then make this two photon excitation, for example, for if they excite to potassium, they should be to N equal 56. And if it's to rubidium, it will be N equal 46, and they will be able to produce this diatomic molecule. Right now, we are working with the group of Simon Cornes that they are able to produce rubidium cesium, and they have a project to create experimentally this molecule up to observe them. And the problem is that they don't have KRB, they have rubidium cesium, and they are right now designing the experiment. So we are doing for them with my student, my PhD student, David Mellado, we are doing the calculation of all the electronic structure for rubidium with rubidium cesium and for cesium for rubidium cesium. And based in our theoretical studies, they will decide if they excite rubidium or cesium. So let me go to my second part of my talk. And let me talk about another kind of diatomic molecule. And the idea now is to keep the diatomic molecule, let's go to another type of Rydberg molecule. And the idea now is to change the diatomic molecule, the diatomic molecule, but to change the Rydberg system. And what we are going to put is a Rydberg molecule with a diatomic molecule. And this is the work Miha was talking, it's done in collaboration with Janin Setzer and Hussein Saktepur. And as Hussein said, it's our first pandemic paper from conception to finish, because we did it where during the first pandemic wave, I arrived at ITAM to make my sabbatical March 2nd. 2 weeks after I was there, Harvard was closed. Europe was closed, everything was closed, but somehow I decided that I was going for my 5 months sabbatical and I'd rather stay there than I came back to Spain, which I think out of the result was a wise decision. So the idea is what we decided to do, we were talking about the idea arriving there was to use NO molecule. As most of you probably know, NO is a very important molecule. It's a neurotransmitter. It's important for vasodilatation in our body. It has many studies about the importance of NO, but at the same time, it's known that it's toxic. When we have too many NO, it will be like act as poison. So due to this importance, there are many studies about NO, and in particular, we have here the potential energy curve as a function of the internuclear distance for NO. Over here, NO minus is here on NO plus. So the group of Tilman Fau in Stuttgart, Annette Grant in UBC in the University of British Columbia in Vancouver, they are working with NO in a Rydberg state. And we decided to use a Rydberg electronic state of this molecule, so we are here, and combine it with a ground state NO. So if I look here, that will be the ground state of electronic ground state of NO. These are X2P1/2 molecule. And if I look here, which is what it's important right now, due to the lambda doublets, this molecule, it could be in the ground state, it could be indeed considered as a two-state model. So I could consider only this two-state with different parity, forget about the rest of the interaction, and take into account that NO is a ground, in the ground state is a two-state model as a first-order approximation. This is the rotational constant that will be the splitting of these two states of the lambda doublet here, and the dipole moment is very small. But it has a dipole moment, which is what we need at the end. And we were able to find in the literature the quantum defect of NO, and then we used the quantum defect of the NO to produce the Ripper wave function of the NO molecule in a Ripper state. So that we are working somewhere around here. So now, how is our molecule? We have NO with NO. It's a very, in a way, it's a very negative molecule, the way it's called this molecule. We have here now NO plus, the Rydberg electron is somewhere here, and then we have here NO. And that's within the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation, that will be our Hamiltonian. We have here the Rydberg electron Hamiltonian. Now we have different potential and so on. We have the diatomic molecule, which is a two-state model. And this is the Hamiltonian of the molecule, is this two-state model with taking into account the interaction with the electric field. And due to the structure and everything, we only take into account the set component around the set axis of this electric field produced by the core and the Rydberg electron. And then as before, we solve the Schrödinger equation in terms of a basis set expansion of the Rydberg electron wave function, and then here this zero and one state that we only have due to the dipole moment. As I said, the dipole moment is very small, but the advantage is that the energy split in between these two states is also very small. So that electronic structure that we get of this, we call it bimolecule, of this bimolecule, of this NO-NO molecule as a function of the internuclear distance, if we look close to the N equal 15. So that will be the degenerate manifold here, the NO will be in the degenerate manifold here, then we have here 50F, 50G, and then we see again as before, we have a nice electronic structure with potential well, and even more important, this potential well are able to accommodate bound state. Now the question here is, what happened with the collision of the electron with the diatomic molecule? So we went back to the literature and we found that there were a lot of measurements and studies about the collision of the electron. Sorry, it's the electron with this NO. I was saying it before. Now it's the collision of the electron with this NO. We were able to find the electron affinity. From the electron affinity, we got the scattering length, S wave scattering length, and the P wave scattering length was measured. So we were able to extract the data. So what we change now is that we are going to take into account the interaction of the dipole moment with the electric field produced by the core and the Rydberg electron, but also the collision of the electron with this diatomic molecule. So we are taking into account the electron NO scattering, which was the only interaction taken into account in the first kind of Rydberg molecule I was talking to you. So now, we solve now the Schrödinger equation and try to see if the electronic structure changes. And I compare here, if I include only charged dipole interaction, and I present here the electronic structure for the same N, if I take into account also this electronic collision. And as you see here, the electronic structure changed significantly. We have here this vertical line here is due to the resonance on the P wave of the electron colliding with the NO. And one of the more significant feature is that this nice and deep potential wave, they have become more shallow, essentially due to this resonance. But still, in green, and in red, we see that their potential well, they are deep enough. And if I compute the wave function, they accommodate a lot of bound state. They can accommodate a lot of bound state. And they are far away in the distance as before. They are around 500 atomic units. And in both cases, for the red coming from 50F and from the green coming from the 15G, in both cases, the NO is pointed away from the core. So we have very nice bound state and the molecule exists and they are well separated in such a way that the electronic structure could, the vibrational structure could be resolved experimentally. So here you have here the energy spacing. Here you have the rotational spacing, which is in the order of the megahertz. They have large dipole moment, as in the previous case, so they could be manipulated very easily, but with very weak electric field. And they have large Rabi frequencies in that cases, which means that they could be created experimentally. We went to a large N. We went to N equal 40. And then we have here again the potential for this bimolecule, the electronic structure as a function of the internuclear distance. And we have blue shifted state here, but we also have this red shifted state, which look very shallow in the scale of the figures, which is a few gigahertz. But if I zoom in the blue state, there are several bound states. And now, as you see, depending if it's in the outer world, the diatomic molecule is pointed away from the Rydberg core or is pointed towards the Rydberg core. And if I look to the red potential coming from the other, here it's coming from the NO in the minus state or NO in the plus state, I also have two bound state. And if I look here from the 40G state, they're also very nice bound state. Some of them, like that one, is very shallow, but there are several vibrational bound state with many and this spacing is large enough. And then depending where they are located, I see the molecule pointing in one direction in the other one. So here you see how the spacing, the vibrational spacing look like, the rotational spacing is now larger. And then I have the dipole moment is even larger because it's square like with N, and then it's a few kilo divide, which is very large. And the Rabi frequency is small, but still large enough to be created. And this is Rydberg state of NO, they are long-lived, so they could be created experimentally. I'm close to the end. I'm going to finish again with an experimental proposal, and is how to create this bimolecule, this NO-NO bimolecules, is first create a sample. They have been, they are able to produce already NO, and I mean, the NO was already studied experimentally for Rydberg state, but now they are observing, they are creating these two groups in Vancouver and Stuttgart. Then make these two photon excitation from the electronic ground state to this intermediate state to this Rydberg state or to that one. That will be able to produce NO and NF or NG. And then with the diatomic molecule, we need also NO in the surrounding closet in order to create, to photo associate to this system. And they could be resolved both rotationally and electronic structure of this system. And with that one, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Yes, so thank you very much. Now we have still time for questions.